This year, I covered contracts one and contracts two. But this semester, we focus on contracts two, the part of contracts involving performance. We assume that a contract was formed and then went on to determine what it meant, whether it was performed, and if not, whether there were damages owed for breach. But just as a reminder, let's take a brief look back at what contracts consist of. In contracts one, we talked about the capacity of contract, who can form a contract. And provided that the parties have that capacity, it requires mutual assent, which is offer and acceptance during the time when there is a power of acceptance. This magical element called consideration, so that bargains are the result of an exchange. And then we learned about several specific defenses, including the statute of frauds, mistake, misrepresentation, undue influence, and duress. And that led us to conclude as to whether or not these parties had a contract. We begin this semester, we begin contracts two, with the presumption, the assumption that a contract has been formed, and now the parties have obligations under it. We begin by interpreting that contract through intrinsic and extrinsic terms. We determine whether certain extrinsic evidence, known as parole evidence, should be admitted to modify, change, or make meaning of the contractual terms. And we also look at what terms were implied by the party's conduct or by law. We then describe those terms as either promises or conditions, and conditions have a major impact on when contract performance is due, which leads us to analyze whether that performance was done. If it was not done, was it excused? And if not excused, what are the remedies? What are the remedies for this contractual breach? In other reviews, I discuss contract formation. So here, I'm going to give you the very short version. A contract is a promise or a set of promises for which the law gives a remedy, or the performance of which the law recognizes as a duty. All of first semester was determining when such an instrument exists. We are now going to presume that it does. And by the way, I drew this image to remind us that it looks sort of like this. We have these exchange of promises, in most cases, between an offeror and or a promisor, and on the other hand, an offeree or a promisee. And to put this in technical language, we exchange the promise for something valuable, consideration. And that is a bargain for exchange. So that's contracts one in a nutshell. Let's move on to contracts two and talk about interpretation. Our semester's inquiry begins here, upon the assumption that parties have formed a contract. And we must adjudicate a dispute in their understanding of their obligations thereunder. One party will claim it either doesn't have to perform, or that it performed and was not paid, or the other party did not perform. And it is up to us to determine who is right and who is wrong, who should pay and who should perform. We use the restatement of contracts heavily. The restatement of contracts is an analysis by the American Law Institute on the present state and perhaps pushing us in a future direction of contract law. In most cases, I use the restatement to state the rule of law, although I've indicated a couple times where our local jurisdiction does not totally agree with the restatement. The restatement here defines the interpretation process and reminds us that interpretation is about determining the intention of the parties, getting in the minds of the parties that made the contract. Well, what if we can't? There are a number of cases where the contractual terms are ambiguous. In fact, the circumstances surrounding the situation are ambiguous. If we cannot determine a party's intent through their express words, or through their actions or the surrounding circumstances, how do we deal with ambiguity in a contract case? Frick Alignment presented that, but it also set us up for understanding that there is a hierarchy to the evidence in contract interpretation. A rough hierarchy, but perhaps a useful hierarchy nonetheless. Leading at the top end, the most persuasive evidence from the express terms the parties actually wrote, and explicit references to extra contractual terms, for example, in statutes, reasonable common sense sort of pervades that conversation. And then we get into the extrinsic evidence, things that were not written but might inform the contract, including course of performance, course of dealing, and uses of trade. And then preliminary negotiations also forms our understanding of the contract insofar as it tells us what the parties intended. But the parole evidence rule, as we will see, bars certain evidence of preliminary negotiations where it is at odds with what the parties actually wrote. So we can break these seven levels or seven types of evidence into three basic concepts. Basically, we have intrinsic evidence to begin with, extrinsic evidence, and then special rules dealing with parole evidence.